The three laws in genetics form the crux of this topic. These laws not only answered a few questions, but were even ahead of their time. They were instrumental in proving a few important concepts which were discovered in the following years. But do all the organisms always follow these fundamental laws? When crossed, do all organisms always give offsprings in the ratios that Mendel obtained? Not really. Even this has exceptions. But before we get to know the exceptions to these laws, let's first try answering some interesting questions that will help us understand the concepts learned so far thoroughly. To begin with, let's imagine we have this plant with axial flowers. We know that the axial flower position trait is dominant over the recessive trait of the terminal flower position. So this plant has the dominant genes for the character flower position. Now this is the phenotype of the plant, which is understood by a mere glance at it. But can you tell me what the genotype of this plant is? Is it homozygous or heterozygous for this character? Let me simplify this for you. Let's consider the alleles A in capital to represent the dominant trait axial position and A in lowercase for the recessive trait terminal position. So can you tell me whether this plant has the genotype AA or AA? Just a glance is not enough. It could be either. Now I'm going to ask you an interesting question and I want you to really try your best to answer it. Is there any way in which you can find the genotype here? Think about it. Maybe a test would help. Can we look at the chromosomes and say which genes are present on them? Nope, that's not possible at all. Then what kind of a testing method would help us? It's simple actually. The only way to know the genotype of this plant is by crossing this with a plant whose genotype is known to us. So what plant will we opt for in order to cross? The best choice will be a plant that is recessive in phenotype. In this case, we will opt for a plant with terminal flowers. But why should we take a plant with a recessive trait? Why not dominant? Because for a recessive plant, it will definitely have the alleles AA both in lowercase. This is the genotype we can be sure about. This is the unknown genotype for us. After crossing, the F1 generation will get one allele A written in lowercase from this parent. So we write these A in all these four places. Talking about the genotype of our plant, there could be two possibilities. One, it could be AA both capital, or it could be AA, one in capital and the other in lowercase. These are the two possibilities or cases. Now let's look at case 1. On crossing, in the F1 generation, we obtain all the plants which have axial flower positions. This means all the plants will be heterozygous with one capital A and one lowercase a. Now we move on to case 2. Look at the plants obtained in the F1 generation. We get two axial and two terminal. They are in the ratio 1 to 1. So what can we deduce from these two cases? Simple. We can guess the unknown genotype by looking at the results in the F1 generation. If we cross our plant with a plant having a recessive phenotype, and we get all the plants with flowers in the axial position, then the genotype of our plant will be AA, both in capital. And if we get plants with dominant and recessive traits in the ratio 1 to 1, then the genotype of our plant will be AA, one in capital and the other in lowercase. So wasn't this interesting? We used another plant to find the genotype of a plant. This type of a cross is referred to as a test cross. It's a cross where the individual's zygosity is found. Zygosity simply means the homozygous or the heterozygous nature. It's found by crossing it with a recessive individual. Test crosses are the most powerful tools used in several experiments. Let's try to solve another question in the next part. Phenotype and genotype are the important concepts which we know pretty well. Now, can you tell me how many phenotypes are obtained on crossing a homozygous plant having round and yellow seeds with another homozygous plant having wrinkled and green seeds? We want the number of phenotypes and not the ratio. Let's crack this together. The first thing we need to note is that we are looking at two characters, seed shape and seed color. We are crossing this plant with the one having wrinkled and green seeds. So isn't this a dihybrid cross? Yes, it is. Now let's get to the next step. We are supposed to calculate the number of phenotypes obtained. On crossing these, the F1 generation, as we know, will always have all the dominant characters expressed. This is because the F1 hybrids are all heterozygous in nature. So there's just one phenotype of the F1 generation that is round and yellow in this case. What about the number of phenotypes in the F2 generation? If you remember the table of any dihybrid cross, we obtained the phenotypic ratio 9 to 3 to 3 to 1. Take a moment to go through this table that we'd seen previously. What will be the number of phenotypes in the F2 generation? As there are four different varieties of plants, we can say that there are four phenotypes. You should know that a dihybrid cross always gives us four different phenotypes in the F2 generation. Now let's make it a bit more interesting. Can you tell me what's the genotypic ratio obtained in the F2 generation after a dihybrid cross? 9 to 3 to 3 to 1 is the phenotypic ratio. You can pause the video and try finding the genotypic ratio of these offsprings. The answer is tricky. The genotypic ratio obtained for the F2 generation is this. Huge, isn't it? Why is it so big? It's because there are 9 different genotypes according to the table. Study of genetics is indeed very interesting. Now, can you answer one more question that Nora has for you? She wants to know which cross or crosses explain the law of independent assortment. Think about the law first. It states that genes for different traits can segregate independently during gamete formation. Now, if we consider a monohybrid cross, then the event of assortment of genes is ruled out as there's only one pair considered at a time. However, when there are two or more genes involved, as we can see in this case, the dominant and the recessive alleles of the different genes assort independent of each other. That is the reason why we get four different combinations at the end. Does this law is best understood when we study dihybrid or higher crosses which involve more characters? D is the best answer. We have been talking about dihybrid crosses and dihybrid ratios since quite some time. Now let's try cracking just one simple question related to a trihybrid cross in the next part. We have been talking about monohybrid and dihybrid crosses for quite a while. Now let's try answering a question related to trihybrid cross. It's very simple. So let's say we consider the three characters like the height of the plant, seed shape and seed color all being genotypically heterozygous. Now can you guess how many possibilities or combinations of gametes will be formed from these? Will there be four possibilities, or six, or eight combinations? You can pause the video and make the necessary calculations on a paper. We get eight possibilities when a heterozygous individual for all the three traits is considered. The simple trick is by using the formula 2 raised to n. Here N is the number of characters considered at a time. Now since this is a trihybrid cross, the formula will be 2 to the power 3, which gives us 8. So there are 8 possible combinations of gametes that are obtained. Now to take it a step ahead, can you tell me the different combinations of genes in these 8 gametes? Let's solve this together. The genotype of this parent is TTRRYY, all letters written in one upper and one lowercase to represent heterozygous genotype. To get the gametes, we take the help of the law of independent assortment. According to the law, the alleles for different genes will assort independent of each other. So in simple words, the alleles T and T will assort independent of the other alleles R and R and even Y and Y. That means the T can be assorted with either R or R and similarly with either Y or Y. There is a simple way to find the combinations. We write the letters capital T and lowercase t 4 times each. Why do we write it 4 times? That's because we know that each allele has the possibility of assorting with all the remaining 4 alleles. So we write the letters T and T like this. Now the second set of genes can be assorted in an alternate fashion written twice. So we write capital R here and here, followed by R in lowercase twice. We repeat the same procedure with the T allele written in lowercase. Now comes the last allele set. Any idea how will this be assorted? Well, it's quite simple. The last set will be written in single alternate fashion. That is, Y in capital followed by Y in lowercase. This is done one after the other to find all the gametes. So a total of 8 gametes, or combinations to be precise, are obtained in an individual that is heterozygous for all the 3 traits. Now let me ask you an extremely interesting question. If we cross a plant having red flowers with a plant having white-coloured flowers, then is there a possibility to obtain an intermediate flower colour like pink? At the first instance, you may say no. Most of us would think that the plants in the F1 generation can either be red or white depending upon the dominant trait. But what if I tell you that there are certain exceptional plants which show this interesting characteristics? Want to know more about these exceptions? For that, we will have to understand the exceptions to Mendelian inheritance. I'll see you in the next part.